Good morning. I'm State Representative Donna Bullock, the chair of the Children and Youth Committee. I am excited about today's informational hearing on childhood nutrition and school meals. Today's hearing is a joint hearing with the Children and Youth Committee as well as the Education Committee. So I would like to thank my colleagues from both committees for joining us today and invite the chairs to briefly introduce themselves, and then we will allow the members to introduce themselves. Starting with Chair Swire.
Thank you, Madam Chairs. And I pluralize it because she has multiple chairs, and I told her I was going to start with that. I also like to thank you for inviting us to participate in this. This is a conversation that we heard that was started, you know, some time ago, but also emphasized quite a bit by Governor Shapiro in his budget address when he started talking about the issues surrounding his proposals with free school breakfast. And so it's a very important conversation, and thank you again for allowing us to participate.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Appreciate all the testifiers today. My name's Jesse Topper. Represent the 78th District. Happy to be here, and to echo Chairman Schwire's comments, we're excited to hear, kind of flesh this proposal out a little more and see what we can do to make things better in our public schools. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm State Representative Barry Joswiak. I represent the 5th District, which is in Berks County. And I'd just like to say good morning to Chairwoman Bullock, members of the Children and Youth Committee and the Education Committee, all the staff that's here, and all of the presenters who are here today as well. Providing our children with the proper nutrition will provide them with energy to learn, play, and grow into healthy adults. I look forward to hearing from our presenters today, and I would like to thank them for taking the time to be here today with us on this important topic. Thank you.
Thank you. And before I provide brief remarks, I would like to have our members briefly introduce themselves as well, starting to my far right.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for being here. My name is Craig Statz, representing the 145th Legislative District in the great county of Bucks.
Good morning. My name is Barb Gleim. I'm in the 199th District in Cumberland County.
Good morning. I'm John Schlegel from the 101st in Lebanon County.
I'm Charity Grimm Krupa. I'm from the 51st District in southern part of Fayette County.
Anthony Bellman from the 203rd District, Philadelphia County.
Mary Isaacson from the 175th District in Philadelphia County.
Good morning, Joe DiOrsi, 47th District, York County.
Good morning, Joe McAndrew, 32nd District, Allegheny County.
Christine Howard, the 167th District in Chester County.
Thank you all for joining us today. We also have on teams with us Representatives Hambridge, Ortiz, Wattrell, Flick, Gentz, Serrato, Hogan, McCurry, McKenzie, Hill Evans, and Shilabra. I believe I got the last one right.
And Cerisi.
Oh, and Cerisi. Thank you for joining us, Cerisi.
Thanks, Donna.
And Propes have, Representative Propes has just joined us as well. Thank you all for joining us. And today's hearing, as I mentioned, is an informational joint hearing between the Children and Youth and Education Committee on childhood nutrition and school meals. And to echo my co-chair, Rep. Joswiak, we want to make sure that our children have the are fed and have the meals that they need to succeed both in school and in home. And we know how important those school meals can be, but also nutrition overall to overall development of our young people. And so with that being said, I want to ask that our panelists today to provide us a summary of your remarks. We have received everyone's written testimony, and we want to be courteous of everyone's time, but make sure that we get the information that is necessary to advise us as we move forward on legislation. And so as you prepare for your remarks, please be as concise as you possibly can. And we will start with our first panel. Representative Emily Kincaid of the 20th Legislative District, followed by Director Sally Zubairu Cofield from the Department of Health Bureau of Women, Infants, and Children. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having this really important hearing. Chairs Bullock, Schweier, Joswiak, and Topper, I really, this is an incredibly important thing to talk about, especially now coming out of COVID and the reality that so many kids are facing, that they have had universal free meals for the last several years and now are facing down, going back to the way that things were when we had free and reduced lunch, and many of these students who experience food insecurity don't qualify for a lot of these programs to begin with. I appreciate that the governor was willing to highlight that in his budget by proposing universal free breakfast, but I don't think it goes far enough, because fundamentally we are asking kids to attend mandatorily school, and the meal that they will always be present in school for is lunch. And we should be providing universal free lunch to any student that we are requiring to be in school. I won't rehash my written testimony, but what I will say is that this really digs into the reality that this isn't for... We are covering the students already who are the poorest and most vulnerable, but we are not necessarily helping the kids who are on the bubble, who don't on paper qualify for these programs. The kids who experience whether their parents can't or won't provide for them in their ability to actually buy school meals. The students who have parents who are financially abusive and will punish their students by not actually sending money to buy meals. It happens. And it's students like me who, my mom was profoundly mentally ill. And for much of my middle school and high school experience, there were a lot of times that if my dad was not home, I did not eat in the evening. So my only meals came from school. My junior and senior year, basically, I will always and forever defend Hamburger Helper because it saved my life. I learned the very, very hard way how that you have to defrost hamburger before you cook it. And I had to do that all by myself because I didn't have a parent who was capable of taking care of me, even though technically she was the adult in the household. And my dad had a job that was out of town for a year and a half, my last year and a half of school. I graduated high school weighing 110 pounds, which is fully 12 pounds below the minimum of what a 5'7 female should be. And it has a lot to do with the fact that I didn't have a consistent meal availability at home, but I did have the ability to pay for school meals, and that made a huge difference. So when we are talking about universal school meals, these are the students that we are leaving behind when we are not providing them with universal meals, when we are saying some students qualify and other students do not. We leave out the circumstances that may impact a student's ability to actually eat regularly just because on paper it says they should be able to. So I have legislation, HB 180, that would provide universal free breakfast and lunch for all students enrolled in public K through 12 schools, as well as increasing the state supplement to our community eligible school districts, and a $25 million increase or $25 million one time to retire student lunch debt in our school districts. All of this would amount to about 0.1% of our overall budget, but the return on investment is astronomical to make sure that our students, our kids, are able to regularly eat, because school meals are the primary source of nutrition for school students, and we have to recognize that. And we have a responsibility as legislators to use taxpayer dollars to do the most good for the most people, and this is a very simple way to do it. Thank you.
Director Subaru Kofu.
Thank you. Good morning. Chairwoman Bullock. Good morning. Is this better? Good morning, Chairwoman Bullock, Chairman Topper, Schweier, and Josiak. First, I'm going to start off by echoing Representative Kincaid. As a department, we are always looking for opportunities that support the access of healthy meals and supporting nutrition for students. We're very excited that the governor's budget proposal continues these programs to ensure free and reduced meals for students in Pennsylvania. It's extremely important, especially as I sat here and listened this morning, that we do whatever it takes to reduce these barriers. Ensuring access to these meals for these students is very crucial. As the director of Pennsylvania WIC, we strive to support nutrition and nutrition education for the families of Pennsylvania. Currently, we serve over 183,000 participants. Of the 183,000 participants, over 165,000 of those participants as of February 28th of 2023 actively use their benefits. There's so much stigma around these sort of programs. And whatever it takes, to whatever we need to do to support these programs, to remove the barriers and remove the stigma, it is crucial to do so. WIC serves infants, children, and families that support infants and children up to age 5. WIC is the nation's premier public health program. We provide not only nutritious foods, but nutrition education and resources to other programs. I've spent my career as a public health educator. Before I was a public health educator, I was a WIC mom. I am also a recipient of a WIC mother. It is so crucial that in this work and in this line of duty, we understand the people that we're serving and the people that need the program. And it's with such little impact to the overall budget, I think it's just, it's crucial, it's vital. My experience as a former WIC recipient deeply informs my leadership and really backs my commitment to serve our participants. In Pennsylvania WIC, with so many of the barriers that many programs face, the pandemic that we recently experienced really opened up lots of challenges, and it allowed us to see different challenges. But with those challenges came opportunities for improvement. One great opportunity and area for improvement was in the community of the vendors. Just like I said earlier, we do so much to allow the access to the foods for the participants. But where the participants need it the most, especially in those rural areas, especially that with areas that have little or no grocery stores, we've got in Pennsylvania lots of bodegas, mom and pops, corner stores. We want to make sure that they're able to assist us in serving these participants as well. In 2021, we seen a decline in Pennsylvania. In Philadelphia alone, over 250 vendors either voluntarily decided that they no longer could afford to participate in the program, or they couldn't meet with the demands that the program needed. In Pennsylvania, our requirements to be a vendor are far more stricter than the federal requirements. Since October of 2022, I'm pleased to say that we've enrolled over 161 vendors on the program in Pennsylvania. We have reduced significantly the minimum inventory stock requirements that the federal regulations allow for a vendor to be a vendor, because we want to ensure that access to the participants is there. We want to make sure that these participants are able to get the food, irregardless of transportation, irregardless of where they live. I deeply appreciate the opportunity to speak to you all about the work of the Pennsylvania WIC program and appreciate the committee's interest in Pennsylvania WIC's role in the provision of childhood nutrition. I thank you for this opportunity again.
Thank you both for your testimony. I have a question, and then I'll allow some of my colleagues to join with a few questions. Dr. Subiru Cofield, you mentioned some of the barriers that need to be removed, and then I heard you mention some of the issues with vendors. Can you elaborate on barriers for families and that create the stigma that we can address legislatively or otherwise?
I'm sorry, not doctor, just Sally.
Gave fine. You a title.
Absolutely.
Ms. Subiru, director.
We're going to speak it into existence. All right. So I'll just name a few of the barriers, but a big one, and you know, as a participant myself, we know that there was an era in WIC where we had paper checks. So we moved and transitioned from those paper checks, and in Pennsylvania now we have an eWIC card. This eWIC card allows participants to go to the grocery store and shop a little more discreetly. However, depending on where you are in the line, who's behind you, people still, there's still that stigma. There's still families that are a little embarrassed to use that card. Right now in Pennsylvania WIC, we are offline, so which means that the participants don't have real access to their benefit balances. It's not in real time. They can't order online, for instance. They can't just pick up the phone if something changed, if the baby's no longer drinking this type of formula. That change can't just be made with a phone call. There are other things that need to happen at this moment. So we're moving from offline to online, which is going to take a couple of years, but we are moving in that direction to do so. Another barrier with the program on the participant side is access, like I said. The markets, grocery stores, sometimes it's just not there for participants. Some participants, there's, and unfortunately, you know, for us, or if we have a vehicle, it's a 10-minute drive or a 5-minute drive to the grocery store is easy. There are participants who don't have that opportunity. So when one store shuts down or one store is no longer able to be a WIC-approved vendor, but there's a store a mile away or a block away, it may seem externally like, well, there's another store down the street, or there's a grocery store that everyone can get to. But for some families, that means a taxi cab ride with 2 or 5 children. That means, you know, I can't afford a taxi, and there may be something that else I need to purchase in the grocery store that my WIC benefits or my doesn't cover, or I don't have enough on my SNAP benefits. So families are juggling between transportation to getting their groceries and actually getting there. So we've also looked into mobile markets. The Pittsburgh area and Giant Eagle partnered up and did a big mobile market initiative. About 2 weeks ago, we were down there and we approved these mobile markets. This is very new, not only to PA WIC, but nationally. And we're hoping to get more mobile markets on so that we can meet the participants where they are. Most recently, we've applied for and received a grant for mobile markets in Pennsylvania WIC, where we're also getting mobile markets and mobile units for the local agencies who serve. We have 22 local agencies that serve Pennsylvania WIC. We're getting these local agencies the opportunity to have mobile markets, and they could also meet the participants where they are. Biggest thing is bridging the gap, trying to meet the participants where they are, removing the stigma of this program. And that's why it's important universally. We can serve infants and children up to age 5, but we also want to make sure that the grandparents and the fathers and guardians and neighbors also can serve these children. We've recently partnered up with the Department of Corrections, and we're looking at ways to serve children of incarcerated parents. As we know, you know, we want to remove these barriers. We want to make sure that if a mother is incarcerated, she doesn't have to wait till there's legal custody of that child for that child to receive services. We want to make sure whoever receives this child is able to feed this child, and food is not an issue. So whatever we can do in Pennsylvania WIC to remove these barriers, that's what we're doing.
Thank you. We have two questions, one from Chair Joswiak and another from Representative Stats.
Thank you, Chairwoman. Emily, moving story. I noticed you have in your bill, your bill covers lunch and breakfast. Is that correct? And is that regardless of any household income for all kids in all schools? Well, what would be the cost for the Commonwealth to do that? Do you have an estimate?
Yeah. So based on enrollment, currently, it would cost about $435 million to cover breakfast and lunch for all students in public school K through 12. My bill also proposes a $30 million increase in the supplement to community-eligible school districts, which would bring it more on par with the federal government, which has almost doubled its supplement on it for those programs. So, you know, in 10, 15 years, we haven't increased our supplement at the state level. But, yeah, the estimate is about $435 million.
Thank you.
Is that $435 million the state's estimate, or is that including what would be reimbursed from the USDA from the federal program?
That's the state's estimate, but my bill also has a clawback mechanism, so that if the federal government does increase its investment in school meals, or actually implements school meals, universal school meals nationally, that we could claw back the funds.
And if you don't mind, I know the definition of community eligible schools, mm-hmm. but can you share it with the rest of the committee? Just so
sure. Briefly, the community eligible programs or the community eligible school districts are school districts that have a level of a certain percentage, and off the top of my head, I'm not sure what that is, but that triggers universal free meals for all of their students because they have a number of families that are at the poverty level. So it triggers a community, the entire community would be eligible then.
Thank you. For example, the city of Philadelphia, and I think many of our cities are community eligible, mm-hmm. Just because they already have a high percentage of low to moderate income families that would be eligible for free or reduced lunch.
Yeah. Pittsburgh is another one.
Right. So many school districts already do. And there are actually more that qualify that may not have applied. So we need to encourage those school districts to apply for community eligibility. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Representative Stats.
Thank you, Madam Chair. My son's... 29 and 27, so they're well removed from the public school system. So I'm just curious, what is the current status of the free breakfast program? I know that during COVID, we had a free breakfast program in place. Has that gone away?
The free breakfast hasn't gone away because Governor Wolf used funds to have the free breakfast program run through this year, although it will go away at the end of this year if we don't continue to implement it. Governor Wolf proposes an ongoing investment in universal free breakfast. And again, I don't think it goes far enough because there are a lot of students that don't arrive at school in time to take advantage of a free breakfast, whether it's because of the bus schedule or because of responsibilities at home. And so there are a lot of students that, while eligible for free breakfast, can't take advantage of it. And so that's why I think that we should also expand that to free lunch.
And while I recognize there's certainly a need, my one concern is why universal free breakfast when there's not a universal need?
Sorry, could you clarify?
My concern is why would we have universal free breakfast when there's not a universal need?
I mean, part of it is around the stigma of, you know, like the director was referring to with WIC, there are students that don't participate in the program because of the stigma of being the poor kid. And what we saw with the pandemic programs that allowed universal free meals is those stigmas went away. And nobody knew what anybody's household income was. Nobody was privy to that. Nobody asked about it. Nobody cared about it. And it allowed students who had access to meals to be able to take advantage of them. It also covered students like myself who struggled with food insecurity but would never have qualified for free or reduced lunch or breakfast, but still had a need for it. And so, you know, we are – what this does fundamentally is it takes away all of the on-paper metrics that say this student – is hungry, that student isn't, and actually just allows them to have lunch. Because we have had schools that have out of school suspended students for eating lunch that they could not afford. And that is a huge problem. It is something that we should never see happen, especially when we have the funds to be able to invest in this. So I believe, and the reason for this legislation that I have is that we need to give our kids every chance to succeed. And this is just a simple way to do that. Thank you.
And thank you for that answer. And thank you for sharing your story once again. I just know there's folks like myself and my wife that would have a problem with the government giving our sons free breakfast. And I think a lot of folks feel that way. We always felt that was part of our job as parents to prepare our sons for the day. And feeding them breakfast was part of that preparation, I guess, is what I'm getting at.
I mean, I would agree with you, but there are tragically far too many parents who don't think that that's their responsibility. Far too many guardians that don't think that that's their responsibility. And we have to do something as legislators to make sure that those children are also supported and protected. And if what we can do is say, everybody gets this so that nobody has to explain why you're getting it, then let's do that. And it doesn't stop any families from sending their kids breakfast to school or lunch to school. You don't have to take part in it, but it is available to you if you need it. And that's really the goal.
Thank you for your answers. I appreciate it.
Thank you. And I'd like to move on to two more questions, and then we'll have our next panel. Representative Grimm Krupa, followed by Representative Schlegel.
Thank you. First of all, I want to thank the representative for being candid and sharing your story. As somebody in elementary school that at times I had a free lunch, at times I had a reduced lunch, I had an elementary school teacher that the way you lined up dictated where you sat in the lunchroom. And she would have the kids that packed, they would line up first. Then the kids that were paying for the lunch, they would line up next, then the reduced lunch, and then the free lunch. So if you had a free ticket, you couldn't sit by your friend who packed. So I appreciate that stigma is real. moving to a different direction, and I know this would just be a slither of the program, but with respect to the WIC, I come from a farming background, so it's in my opinion, there's nothing more nutritious than your local farmer who is doing the roadside stand. So has there been an exploration of, and I'm sure with the vending issues that you talked about, that there is, that's all, you know, probably not the most practical solution, but in terms of meeting your participants where they're at, wouldn't it be great if those people from those rural communities could access your local farm stand? So is that something that's been discussed? Is that something that's possible right now?
Absolutely, and we do participate in the Farmers Market Nutrition Education Program, where USDA provides a stipend to local farmers. Right now, our goal and our mission is to try to get these farmers on the program. We provide a $25 stipend to our WIC participants so that they can shop at local farmers. Right now, what we're trying to do during June through September is have these farmers meet the participants at the local WIC offices or in communities, and then set up where we're able to serve, local WIC representatives are able to serve at these farmers market events. So we're there, we're on site, we have our vouchers in hand. Some of the farmers who participate are even able to match the $25. So if a participant purchases $25 using their WIC benefits, they also match them up to $20 or five, some only $5, some match up to $50 with fresh produce for the participants as well.
That's wonderful news. Should the local farmers reach out to their local WIC office for more information about
that? They can, and we've also reached out to them. We've reached out to the Farmers Market Association of Pennsylvania. Okay. So we're really proactive. We're also looking at resources for grant opportunities because we do know that there is a cost to operate, especially stand-besides, and they need, you know, some of them don't just want the vouchers, but you want to be able to use your WIC fruit and vegetable benefit, where we're giving participants up to $30 in a WIC fruit and vegetable benefit as well, to use that benefit at the farmer's market as well. But there's also costs that are incurred with them to use the stand besides and actually become WIC vendors too.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Rep. Schlegel.
Thank you. Thank you. In reading in the written testimony, I read it to express the point that breakfast and lunch would be provided to any student that desired it. And I was just wondering, is there an administrative piece to this to account on how many students would actually want to partake of the program? Or has any thought been given to how that might work?
So the language is broadly written to direct the Secretary of the Department of Education to calculate, based on the prior year's enrollment, an amount to, you know, sort of daisy chain down the line to trigger the treasurer to release funds to the schools. But it's based on enrollment, so that, you know, because what we see is that if you put in a hard number, you say this is based on participation, current participation, we have seen that participation increases when these meals are universally available. And so it's not in the legislation to say, you know, that it's based on participation, it's based on enrollment, because more and more students participate in these programs when they are available and they know that they are available.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to both of our panelists. We'll now move to panel number two, Dr. Amaka Nnamdi and Jonathan Stein, who will be joining us virtually. Please join us at the table. And as I had instructed the previous panel, we're asking that if you can summarize your presentation, and I know you will get a written testimony, your full written testimony to the group later. Thank you. Sure, Dr. Amaka Nnamdi is with the Pennsylvania Psychiatric Institute here in Harrisburg and the American Academy of Pediatrics Pennsylvania chapter. And Jonathan Stein is the school meals advocate and former general counsel at Community Legal Services in Philadelphia and also with Children First PA. Dr. Nnamdi, thank you. Please. Oh, excuse me, before you begin, Dr. Nnamdi, we've been joined by Representative Krajewski online. Excuse me, Dr. Nnamdi, can you press the button before you and then bring the mic closer to you?
Thank you. Is that better? Awesome. Thank you for that kind introduction. So as you said, my name is Dr. Amaka Nnamdi, and I am a general pediatrician currently contracting with the Pennsylvania Psychiatric Institute. I am also a chapter breastfeeding coordinator for the Pennsylvania AAP and obviously a very avid advocate for breastfeeding and infant nutrition. I'd like to thank the members of the House Children and Youth Committee and the House Education Committee for giving me the opportunity to speak with you all. I am proud to join you today as a representative of the Pennsylvania AAP. So the AAP is a nonprofit professional organization of nearly 2,300 primary care physicians, pediatrics, which includes pediatric medical subspecialties and pediatric surgical specialists. And we're all dedicated to the health, safety, and wellness of infants, children, and adolescents. And today we'll be discussing the importance of childhood nutrition in school meals. What I did not say is that I'm also a mom of three, two school-aged children, two daughters, aged 11 and 8, and a toddler who is almost 3 years old. Now, while getting ready for this testimony, I couldn't help but ask them to kind of tell me on a scale of 1 to 10, with 10 being the best quality of food that they got, you know, at school. They actually each gave it a 7 out of 10. And as a busy mom, there have been days where I have just simply not had the time to pack lunch, and they have, you know, been recipients of school lunch, you know, paid. But interestingly, I asked my 8-year-old why she gave it a 7 out of 10, and she said, you know, the meat could be a little more tasty, which got me really laughing, because I was like, you know, it's a school lunch and not a Michelin star restaurant. But I thought I'd just share that because I thought it was pretty interesting. I'd like to start by establishing what constitutes a nutritious meal. Next, I'd like to discuss the effects of child nutrition on short and long-term health outcomes. And I'd like to outline the relationship between child nutrition and academic performance and long-term success. And in closing, I will discuss why it's crucial that we expand access to nutritious school meals to children across the Commonwealth. The AAP supports school meals that follow the Dietary Guidelines for Americans 2020 to 2025, which recommends that people aged 2 years or older follow a healthy eating pattern that includes a variety of fruits and vegetables, fiber, whole grains, fat-free and low-dairy products, a variety of protein foods, and healthy oils. To qualify for reimbursement, as we shortly just spoke about, all lunches provided under the National School Lunch Program must meet federal nutrition requirements. And therefore, the AAP considers lunches that are provided under the National School Program nutritious. We all know that nutrition is key to health, right? But there is no time more critical to lifelong health than the childhood years. And call me biased, but, you know, as a pediatrician, but I know that the decisions that we make as children really go on to affect our lifestyles as adults and the, you know, the decisions that we make. Proper nutrition in the child and adolescent years is essential to keeping current and future generations healthy across the lifespan. A healthy diet helps children grow and develop properly and reduces their risk of developing chronic diseases like obesity and heart disease and stroke and things like that. And in addition, healthy meals are an essential key component of learning and growing. Child malnutrition has been linked to poor health outcomes, inadequate growth, and also hindered cognitive development, while proper nutrition has been linked to higher and stronger academic performance. Not only does childhood nutrition affect a child's short and long-term health outcomes, but it can also play a significant role in their ability to learn. Now, according to the CDC, children who eat less fruits, vegetables, and dairy tend to have lower grades and nutrient deficits, such as vitamins A, B6, and B12, and are linked to higher rates of absenteeism and being tardy, and as well as poor grades. Inadequate nutritional intake can also affect the formation of human capital. Deficiencies in zinc and iron and iodide have been linked to less cognitive development. And we know that nutritious school lunches can make students more attentive and raise their energy level, thereby improving academic performance. Every day, more than 1 million children and students across the Commonwealth receive meals through the federal school nutritious programs. We also know that children consume sometimes up to 50% of their meals during, you know, in the school environment. It's roughly about 35 to 40%. But children can consume up to 50% of their meals in the school setting. It's therefore critical that the food being offered in schools is nutritious. School-provided meals are important as well, because increased access to nutritious foods, because it increases access to children who may normally not have had access to that. School meals programs have a profound effect on the diet quality of children, especially for children at risk of food insecurity. Now, while all students can participate in school meal programs, it is important that these meals are nutritious. Good nutrition, as we kind of talked about now, is essential to health for all the reasons that have been previously mentioned. And providing widespread access to nutritious school meals is critical to promoting the health and well-being of our children in Pennsylvania. And I'd like to leave you today with a statement from the former First Lady, Michelle Obama, who said, "The cafeteria is one of the most important classrooms in the entire school because our kids don't stop learning at lunchtime. Every day with the food you serve, you're teaching them these critical lessons about nutrition and healthy eating. You're shaping their habits and their preferences, and you're affecting the choices that they're going to make for the rest of their lives. So now, just multiply that by the 31 million kids at the time of this writing in the school meal program, and it's clear that all of you don't just shape the future of individual students, you help to shape the future of this country. If you have any questions about what we've shared today, I'm happy to answer them or take them in a follow-up question. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nnamani. Now we'll hear from Mr. Jonathan Stein.
Yes, good morning, everyone. I hope I'm loud and clear from Philadelphia here. I'm Jonathan Stein, speaking for Children First Pennsylvania. And first want to thank each of the representatives here from the Children and Youth and Education Committees for this hearing, which we hope will be a major bipartisan step toward ending hunger among children in Pennsylvania schools. I've been a legal aid lawyer at Community Legal Services for over 50 years, including as executive director, now retired. And one of my accomplishments around 1990 was to establish with the school district here in Philadelphia, the nation's first universal type free meals program. A model that 20 years later was adopted by Congress for the entire country called Community Eligibility Provision. There are about 500,000 Pennsylvania kids in the Community Eligibility Provision program, but as Representative Kincaid earlier emphasized, great numbers of Pennsylvania kids, including many who suffer food insecurity every day, are excluded from this program. They are working class kids, low middle income, lower income kids, and they're across the state. And they are not, because of federal poverty criteria and other factors in terms of federal reimbursement, they are not getting free meals today and are suffering food insecurity. We applaud Governor Shapiro's budget proposal for $38.5 million, to continue Governor Wolf's initiative for universal free breakfast into the 23-24 school year. But we can and should do better than ensure only that children will not go hungry for the first half of the school day. To end hunger for the entire school day, the General Assembly should pass Representative Kincaid's and Senator Lindsey Williams' No Student Should Go Hungry Universal Meals legislation. As you may know, the federal pandemic school meals waiver allowed universal free lunches and breakfast nationwide, but that ended last year. Yet the data is conclusive from this recent experience that universal free meals resulted in increased academic achievement, improved diet quality, reduced food insecurity, and had the potential to reduce obesity by improving BMI. One of the particular benefits of universal school meals is that it ends the terrible stigma and discrimination that attends to children who receive free meals. Stigma, as you've heard, is a contributing factor for children refusing to take advantage of this program, despite they endure hunger. And sadly, stigma is concomitant with the Dickensian and infamous school meal debt that is so pervasive in our state. Dickensian as well, because Pennsylvania by law allows school districts to restrict student privileges and activities for families who owe money on school meals. The added benefit of universal meals is the reduction of paperwork and administrative costs borne by school districts administering means-tested meals programs. And as I said, for too many Pennsylvania kids, they are not eligible for free meals as a result of federal criteria that we don't have to detail right now. Universal meals is the answer to ensure that no school child goes hungry in any school in Pennsylvania. The second point, which I think is really worth emphasizing to this legislature right now, is Pennsylvania does not have to wait for federal policy changes to make sure fewer kids suffer from hunger. This body can take immediate action and update the state supplement funding to local school districts for school meals. Unchanged since 2001, for 22 years frozen, Pennsylvania's basic 10 cents a meal supplement, 12 cents if you're in the federal program, 14 cents if you have over 20% breakfast participation. This 10 cents recognizes, as do a majority of states who supplement, that federal meals reimbursements are inadequate to meet rising food and staffing costs. In the over 20 years that the Pennsylvania supplement has remained frozen, food costs have risen over 60%. Most school food programs are enterprise funds, meaning they are expected to generate revenue to meet their meals and operating costs. Without adequate state supplements, a school food services director has told me this past week that the resulting pressure to reduce food service costs drives down the nutritional quality of school meals, causing districts to rely, for example, on cheaper, less nutritional iceberg lettuce versus dark green lettuce, not providing fresh fruits, not serving whole grain breads, and limiting food items and mixed menus that make school meals appealing to students. During the pandemic period, the feds provided a 40-cent supplement for school district lunches and 15-cent supplement for breakfast, but this expires in a couple of months on June 30th. We recommend that the legislature raise the frozen state supplement that hasn't been increased, as you know, since 2001, by continuing to pay districts at the level districts receive for this fiscal year into next year. And thereafter, we recommend that the state supplement for school meals be increased annually via legislation that requires the supplement to be indexed for inflation. Doing so can avoid another 20 years of inaction. And increased state supplements can also target allied nutrition policies like increasing breakfast participation by providing supplemental increases on a graduated scale to encourage local school districts to provide free breakfast. Extremely important in our state, which doesn't even require that every school and every school district have a school breakfast program. And lastly, Oregon is doing a really creative thing with state supplements right now, is considering closing the gap in the federal community eligibility program. And this uses state supplement funds to top up federal reimbursements that would enable schools that now meet the poverty student eligibility for CEP and allow them to get 100% funding for free meals in the CEP program. But my last subject is something that can be done at very minimal cost, because there's far more than the executive branch of state government can do to save children from hunger. Consider this fact, that at least four major anti-hunger programs targeting children are administered by three separate state agencies: the School Lunch and Breakfast Program and the Child and Adult Care Food Program are in the Education Department. The WIC program that you've just heard about is in the Health Department. The SNAP program, formerly called food stamps, is at DHS. So we propose that new legislation to require the formation of an interagency council to end child hunger with anti-hunger advocates included, that could boost coordination among state agencies and departments to maximize food program participation and expand nutrition outreach. As some examples, Families who receive school meals could be referred by the Ed Department and local schools to SNAP and other food programs so they can afford a nutritious dinner and meals all summer and on weekend. A free school meals family could get referred to WIC for that infant sibling who's at home. And early education programs could connect families with food programs. And finally, this year, when tens of, maybe hundreds of thousands of people in Pennsylvania are going to lose medical assistance because the pandemic is unwinding the continuous MA coverage that we've had in the last couple of years, DHS could be informing those families losing medical assistance of food support programs across the state. Governor Shapiro, in his budget address, said, quote, "It shouldn't be okay for anyone here, especially when we're talking about a $44 billion budget, that people are going to bed hungry and kids are going all day without a meal. Now is the time for one, to adopt the universal free school meals legislation, two, to greatly increase the state supplement to local school districts, a supplement frozen since 2001, and third, to create an interagency anti-hunger council to make it accountable to the governor's office so Governor Shapiro can provide the effective and motivated leadership to do even more to deliver on his compassionate call to action. On behalf of Children First Pennsylvania, we thank you for your commitment to end student hunger in Pennsylvania and for this opportunity to testify. And I'd like to suggest a little experiment as a little improvisation for everyone in this hearing room. We're nearing the lunch hour. To really experience what it means to be without lunch, I would suggest that all of us, myself included, go without lunch in the next hour and then see how you're feeling and how you're functioning at 1 p.m., at 2 p.m., and 3 p.m. And take some notes about how you're functioning then, and maybe even send something into the hearing record here to say how you experienced a lack of lunch yourself today after this hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stein, and thank you, Dr. Namani. Depending on how long Mr. Stein takes to answer our questions, we might just be here through the lunch hour. No, thank you. I joke with it. I worked with Mr. Stein when I was at CLS as a baby lawyer, so it's great to see you on screen there, John. We have two questions so far from Chair Topper and Representative Gleim. Chair Topper?
Thank you. Thank you both for your testimony. And Dr. Namani, I remember when I have two boys, they're teenage boys now, but I remember when they were in elementary school and the first time that my eldest, who just got his driver's license yesterday, which is scary on many levels, came home and said, "Dad, the milk doesn't taste like real milk." And I was like, "I don't know what that means." But of course, that was post removing of the whole milk from the cafeteria. As a pediatrician, What are your thoughts in terms of the health benefits as we kind of reevaluate where we're at with school nutrition when it comes to whole milk?
Thank you. And congrats on him getting his license. That's pretty exciting. So the AAP recommends that we switch to 2% milk after age two. So we typically recommend, so from birth to 6 months, exclusive breastfeeding is what we recommend. With continuation of breastfeeding up to age two, that those are updated guidelines as of June 27th of last year. So for infant feeding, birth to 6 months exclusively, introduction of complementary foods at 6 months with the introduction of whole milk if necessary at a year of age, and then switching to 2% milk by age two. The reason for that switch to 2% milk is primarily because we're seeing a lot of obesity in our children today. So that is a way to kind of help reduce that. So that is our recommendation. Now, in terms of I do have patients who don't like dairy or just allergic to it, and then we recommend other substitutes there's all this plant-based milk, almond milk and this coconut milk and oat milk and things like that. But we also usually want to be aware of those other substitutes because, for instance, if you're drinking goat's milk, you can have a deficiency of folate. So we want to make sure that you're not missing out on any micronutrients.
Because at the moment, there's skim milk and 1% that's offered, and even maybe perhaps, allowing 2%. But And I do. I understand, you know, childhood obesity and what we're battling. I do think, you know, when it comes to milk, that is probably one of the least likely culprits if you look at the total, you know, totality of child nutrition. But as we think of policy moving forward, as it surrounds nutritional school breakfast and lunch, I do believe the conversation of milk will be a part of that. And if I didn't ask the question, I would be, I'm sure Representative John Lawrence, my friend, would be very disappointed if I didn't bring it up. So thank you very much for your answer.
Thank you, Chair Topper. The John Lawrence reference is just for us representatives. Inside joke. We will now have Representative Gleim followed by Representative McKenzie online.
Thank you, Ms. Chairwoman. I just have a quick question. If Pennsylvania decided to use whole milk instead of the 2% or skim, would we still get federal reimbursement?
Jonathan, would you know the answer to that question?
No, I'm sorry, I don't.
That's okay. Something we can try to find out, yeah.
Yeah, I, as a farmer myself and also a fan of John Lawrence's bill, whole milk is more nutritious than skim, and I think it stays in the belly longer and keeps the kids fuller longer than skim. That's also just from a mom's perspective with three kids as well. And then my next question was for Mr. Stein. Since the school lunch regulations were put in place under the Obama administration, has child obesity been reduced? And if so, by how much?
Yeah, I don't have a precise answer to that, but I do know that in the studies that were done of the free meals in the last 2 or 3 years, they did find an improvement in BMI for children who were in that program. And I believe in my written testimony, you will see in footnote 4 an article from in 2021 in Nutrients, which reviews the performance in diet quality, food security, and body mass index, BMI. And in that study, I think it shows that there were improvements in BMI for many children who participated in the free meals program.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Representative Gleim. Representative McKenzie online.
Yes, thank you to everyone who's testified today. Having been a teacher and spent many years in school cafeterias, I saw tons of food being thrown away. And I'm just wondering what's going to happen to all the wasted food. I hate to see wasted food. And, you know, it's going to end up in our landfills, the packaging and everything else. And I just wonder if anyone's thought about that. And the other thing, I'm just going now on my own district, which is the 131st district. I'm sure we have some lower income students. And to those representatives whose teachers made them feel inferior or, you know, unloved by having to take, a federally funded free lunch or whatever, I want to apologize to them because I think a good teacher would be very sensitive to the children's feelings in the cafeteria setting and not deliberately try to, you know, group them together. I just was a little bit horrified to hear that. But I'm also wondering about childhood obesity because say the children do have food and responsible parents who give them breakfast, and then they'll go to school and they'll eat a second breakfast, which might be calories that they don't really need. And I think it could lead to overeating and childhood obesity. I'm not sure if that's, you know, a reasonable thing, but I think this is just another example of the one size fits all in our education system. It doesn't. So I'm a little troubled by the idea of universal, because I don't think it's really going to benefit everyone equally. And I'd love to help the people who really need the help and really need the food, but I see problems with it being universal. Thank you.
Yeah, if I can respond to Representative McKenzie, I think the problems are greater in not having universal. I mean, there's no perfect solution one way or another, but if the current system of means testing and exclusion of great numbers of children mean their lives are thwarted, their academic potential is thwarted, I mean, that should be the most serious issue that we should address. And often, you know, a universal system, you know, is the answer, not the perfect answer, but the best answer we have to prevent even one hungry child who can't reach his or her academic potential in a Pennsylvania school. On your first point about waste, that problem, which does crop up, is a reflection of the underfunding of food services in school districts. As I said in my statement, when the state supplement gets frozen for 22 years and you have inadequate federal reimbursements, food services directors, and I've spoken to many over the years, cut corners. And they cut corners by, you know, offering just one type of meal, not a choice. The meals may be less appetizing, and they do that because they're under the gun to meet a budget that is inadequate to provide a mix of appealing food. So part of the answer of dealing with uneaten food is to incentivize and provide adequate funding to local school districts so food services directors can provide appetizing food that kids will eat. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Representative McKenzie. Thank you to both Mr. Stein and Dr. Anami for your testimony. We will now be moving on to our final panel. And I ask again that our panelists try to summarize their remarks as we have your written testimony in our packets. We will hear from Nicole Malia, the Public Policy and Legislative Chair for the School Nutrition Association of Pennsylvania, better known as SNAP PA or SNAPA, SNAPA, and Mr. Shay Saman, the Chief Financial Officer and I believe interim CEO of Feeding Pennsylvania. Ms. Malia, you may start.
Thank you, and thank you for having me here today. I am a registered dietitian and have been a school food service supervisor for the past 10 years in Chester County, and I grew up in Bucks County. The School Nutrition Association of Pennsylvania is very supportive of what everyone has said so far, expanding funding for school meal programs and reviewing anti-hunger action in Pennsylvania. As we near the lunch hour and we are feeling a little hungry and a little less focused, I want you to imagine your 14-year-old self sitting in school right before lunch. You have completely stopped listening to the teacher because you are hungry and you can smell the garlic bread baking in the cafeteria, the smell wafting through the halls. Now imagine your next thought is to worry about whether your mom or your dad or your parents or guardians put money on your meal account. You know you can get a meal, and food service staff does not mention your negative debt, but you overheard your mom worrying about how to pay for lunches and how to pay off negative balances. You remember last year when lunches were free, and you didn't have to think about if there was money on your meal account. Everyone was free, so all the kids got lunch together. Nobody had to worry about whether they could afford meals, and it was just part of the school day. Now back to today. Feeding America's Map the Gap shows that this scenario could be a reality for nearly 29% of children under the age of 18 who do not qualify for federal nutrition programs but are still food insecure. You will see that currently two-thirds of students enrolled in schools participating in the National School Lunch Program, that 60% of our students are now eligible for free meals. This increased from 54% pre-pandemic. I want to point out that to qualify for free meals, a family of four must make less than $39,000 a year. According to the United Way in 2018, prior to the inflation that we're currently living in, a family of four required $69,000 annually to be able to just make ends meet. Adequately funding school meal programs ensures that no student goes hungry. We need to remove barriers that students could experience due to no fault of their own to accessing school breakfast and school lunch. We need to make sure in this Commonwealth that school meals are as accessible as textbooks, technology, and transportation. School meal programs are the only area in the school day where children have to worry about having money. By removing barriers to quality, daily, nutritious meals, you are ensuring that every student is ready to learn and their most basic need is being met, and the cycle of food insecurity is broken. The School Nutrition Association of Pennsylvania applauds the steps that the Shapiro administration has taken in recognizing this need and funding school breakfast for all students and for allowing students who qualify for reduced price meals to receive them at no cost. This school year, since breakfast has been free for all students, we have seen a 16% increase in participation of free eligible students. So expanded access not only helps those who would normally qualify for free meals, expanded access not only helps those who would not normally qualify for free meals, but those who do qualify as well. The stigma that breakfast is just for free kids is gone, and school meals are just another part of the school day, setting all kids up for success. It is no longer a conversation about the families who can afford to pay. They are now the minority in our state. We now need to worry about how we can help the majority of our families who are struggling, and school meals and expanded access is the answer. Thank you for your time today. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Mr. Salmon?
Thank you. Hope everybody can hear me. Sounds like I'm on. Thank you, Chairwoman Bullock, Chairman Schweier, Chairman Joswiak, and Chairman Topper, as well as other members of the Children and Youth and Education Committees here today. Thank you for the invitation to allow Feeding Pennsylvania to testify and for the opportunity for us to share a perspective on childhood hunger and nutrition. Again, my name is Shay Salmon. I am the Chief Financial Officer of Feeding Pennsylvania and currently serving as the interim CEO. Feeding Pennsylvania, we are the statewide association of nine Feeding America food banks. That includes Phil Abundance, Second Harvest Food Bank of the Lehigh Valley, CEO Weinberg Food Bank, Helping Harvest Food Bank, located in the Reading area, Central Pennsylvania Food Bank, Westmoreland County Food Bank, Greater Pittsburgh Community Food Bank, Community Food Warehouse of Mercer County, and the Second Harvest Food Bank of Northwest Pennsylvania. Together, we serve nearly 2 million Pennsylvanians across all 67 counties of the state, which includes over 500,000 children. And as we, all the time in our work, we hear countless stories like the ones that Representative Kincaid shared earlier about people who are struggling with food insecurity, both those that qualify and those that don't. Our members serve as community hubs and distributors of charitable food. They acquire commodities through various means, through wholesale purchases, retail donations, federally funded programs like the Emergency Food Assistance Program, or TFAP, and state programs like the State Food Purchase Program and the Pennsylvania Agricultural Surplus System, or PASS program. Through these programs, they distribute those commodities to neighbors in need through large decentralized networks of around 3,000 community partners across Pennsylvania that include church pantries, senior centers, and other community organizations. Annually, our entire network of charitable food organizations sources and distributes over 160 million pounds of food to neighbors in need. The current approach to addressing hunger, and particularly child hunger, is a piecemeal but a comprehensive approach where different programs address different needs. Our food banks support and provide food to youth-specific programs like school pantries and backpack programs, making sure that every child and their family has access to fresh, nutritious food in the evenings and on weekends. Our food banks also sponsor and help administer federal programs, such as the Child and Adult Care Feeding Program and the Summer Food Service Program. These programs provide children with nutritious meals at daycares, during after-school programs, and in the summertime when schools are closed. These efforts help to ensure children eat when schools are closed are a key part of addressing childhood food insecurity. However, the largest and most comprehensive tools in addressing childhood food insecurity are while children are in school, through the school breakfast program and the National School Lunch Program. Pre-pandemic, these two programs served more than 30 million meals daily across the country, and that number has only continued to grow due to economic uncertainty and rising inflation. For some children, school meals are the only reliable source of food that they have access to. School nutrition programs are vital tools in reducing child hunger and supporting students' educational achievements. Multiple studies, some published by the Food Research and Action Center, show that availability of school meals reduces food insecurity among children. Students who face hunger are more likely to repeat a grade, experience developmental impairments, and have social and behavioral problems. Plus, participation in these programs alleviates pressure on food banks while also freeing up funds for parents to pay for other necessities such as housing costs, medicine, and gas and vehicle expenses to get to and from work. The role of the school breakfast program and the National School Lunch Program are critical cornerstones in addressing child food insecurity and cannot be overstated. Food banks are and will continue to be there for neighbors and children in need. However, programs like the School Breakfast Program and the National School Lunch Program, which serve children in need directly at their schools and in their communities, continue to be some of the most effective tools we have in combating child hunger in our communities. And considering the recent rise in demand for food assistance, along with the sunsetting of the SNAP emergency allotments, food banks and other nutrition programs will be needed more than ever. And I would just like to add that Feeding Pennsylvania would support any legislation that provides food to children and our neighbors in need. We would like to thank the General Assembly for their interest in learning more about these important programs and encourage you to continue to support a comprehensive approach when it comes to addressing hunger in our communities. Thank you for the opportunity again to testify today, and I look forward to answering any questions you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Samian and Ms. Malia, for your testimony. I wanted to ask a question. I'm not sure who would be best to answer. But when it comes to children participating in after-school programs, particularly our athletes, how do we best prepare, make sure that they have the nutrition they need? I remember seeing an article maybe a year ago about how many of our athletes are participating in sports and are basically malnourished. They're not getting enough food. They may also be students who are not getting access to free or reduced lunch, and then they're participating in sports on top of that.
I would kind of go back to the waste conversation originally and encourage students to really participate in the lunch program and ensure that they're getting all aspects of the lunch to make sure that they are nourished and getting the benefits of that meal. There are after-school programs, the supper program for schools that would qualify that are available in schools that participate. So those would be one aspect to help and assist with athletes. Okay.
Thank you. Are there any additional questions from the members? I don't see any. Well, thank you to both of our panelists for today. I appreciate your comments. And thank you to all of our panelists that have joined us throughout the day. Before I provide my closing remarks, I would like to offer that opportunity to my co-chairs, starting with Chair Topper.
I'd like to thank all the testifiers. I do appreciate it. And thank you, Chairwoman Bullock, for hosting this hearing. I do think just something that has been touched upon, especially with this last panel, is the idea of the fact that summer does come, weekends come. And, you know, we've found in our communities that it is becoming, we know that this situation of students who have food insecurities outside of school, it's becoming more of a community issue. And we see, and I'd like to recognize the organizations and the local churches, those who have stepped up to meet those needs. And we have those, you know, in the communities that I serve, and I want to thank them for, you know, hosting those, the backpack lunches, and I think communities are starting to rally around that idea, independent of government, which I always like to see as a Republican work a little better. But I do see that around the district, and I would hope that that would continue, and thank you for bringing that point up as well. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. Chair Jaswiak?
Again, I would like to say thank you to everybody. This was very enlightening for me, some of these things. And I was quite impressed by the quality of testifiers today. You're all experts in your field, and it's important for us to hear those facts. Thank you.
And Chair Schwier.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I represent three very distinct school districts, one of which is very affluent, one is okay, stable, and one is a community school district, community need district. That's the Allentown School District. It's where my children go. My children are part of the 18% of our school district that would not qualify for free or reduced lunch if not for the fact that we were a district of community need. The mere fact that my children can walk into line with everybody else and there's literally no conversation about which kid's the rich kid, which kid's the poor kid, makes a giant difference in the socialization and the overall culture of our schools. Furthermore, the opportunity for free breakfast or free lunch sometimes just makes it easier on a parent. There are real life concerns at homes. There's mental health, addiction, poverty. Yes, there's also just bad days. For every parent sometimes just has a bad day, and they're struggling in that morning to be able to get their everything that they need to do in the course of the day. I think this is the kind of conversations that, frankly, we haven't been having in the General Assembly for over a decade. And I'm excited that we're actually having these conversations. Chairwoman Bullock, thank you for letting the Education Committee participate in this, and appreciate all the testifiers as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chair Schwier, and thank you to all of my co-chairs for joining us today and for the members of both the Education Committee and the Children and Youth Committee. This is an important issue, and I think more important or significant that we're talking about this issue this particular month. March is National Nutrition Month, and if we are going to talk about nutrition, we better make sure we're making sure our children are getting the food and meals that they need to grow, to develop appropriately, to be able to participate in high school sports, after-school programs, and to learn in the classroom. I share personal stories, just like Representative Kincaid, Representative Grim Cooper, who shared her story, and many of us, whether we've personally experienced childhood hunger or know others, this is not an issue that is just in Philadelphia or just in Pittsburgh or in one rural county or another. It is across the Commonwealth where we are seeing families trying to make sure that their children have what they need to survive. Parents skipping a meal so that their child can eat. Students like myself who signed up for every club because they had pizza after school, and I knew that's a place where I can get a meal. Families relying on a number of state programs that are available so that they can pay the light bill because they knew they were going to get some support from WIC or some other program. These are the kind of stories that make up the fabric of this Commonwealth, but we need to make sure that we do what we can as legislators to increase access to healthy foods in our schools and healthy food in our community. So I thank you for taking the time today during National Nutrition Month as we close it out to address this very important issue. And I'm committed to work with my colleagues to work on legislation and perhaps some budget dollars to make sure we get the resources to our communities. Thank you again. Everyone have a great day. The meeting is adjourned.